Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Public Option: How to Expand Freedom, Increase Opportunity, and Promote Equality by Ganesh Sitaraman and Anne L. Alstott. Narrated by Christopher Grove. Introduction. The role of public institutions in our lives is so familiar that we mostly don't give them much thought. We stop by the local post office to mail a letter without reflecting on the public support that makes it possible to send that letter anywhere in the country for less than a dollar. We drop off our kids at the public school and take the subway, train, or highway to work. Many of us have attended state universities, and many more have vacationed at a national park or cooled off at a public swimming pool. And we count on Social Security and Medicare to provide security for us after we retire. Since the founding of our country, Americans have drawn on the power of public action to lay the foundations of the freedom and equality that we prize. These foundations are, in large measure, made up of the very institutions that we take so much for granted. It's not a radical idea to acknowledge that public institutions, funded by the public and voted on by the public, play an essential role in our everyday lives. What is new, and what we focus on in this book, is that many beloved American institutions take a distinctive form that we call the public option. The public option refers to a government program with two features. It provides an important service at a reasonable cost, and it coexists, quite peaceably, with one or more private options offering the same service. You can mail a package via the U.S. Postal Service, or you can pay Federal Express to deliver it more quickly. You can vacation in Yosemite National Park for a moderate fee, or, if you can afford it, pay for fancier digs in a private resort. You can check out a book for free from the public library, or you can buy your own private copy at a bookstore or online. As these examples suggest, the public option is often attractive because it offers a high-quality service for a reasonable price. But it is an option, competing directly with other options provided by the private market, a form of competition that can be beneficial to both the public and the private realm. This aspect of the public option makes it a very American institution. It leverages public resources without preempting private provision. We believe that the public option has the potential to do even more. We explain in this book that new public options could transform many different spheres of life, from childcare to college, from banking to retirement, and beyond. The idea of the public option has recently been in the news thanks to the debate about health care coverage. In the lead-up to the passage of the Affordable Care Act in 2010, policymakers struggled with how to guarantee universal coverage at a reasonable price. One promising proposal, though it was not enacted, was called the public option, a government health insurance program that would be offered alongside private plans and would ensure that anyone could buy coverage at a fixed, affordable price. The public option in healthcare has three big advantages. First, it's public. The government, unlike a private company, can guarantee access to healthcare at a fixed price. Two, it's an option. No one has to use it. If the public insurance plan is a good deal, well, then snap it up. But if you like the terms offered by Aetna or Blue Cross better, then sign up with them. Finally, because the public option exists alongside the private option has to compete to make a better product, something especially important in highly concentrated sectors like healthcare. The public option didn't make it into the Affordable Care Act, but it is a feature of many other institutions that are central to American life. The public school movement opened up the possibility of education to the American masses, an option previously available only to families that could afford private tutors or schools. The Postal Service offers a public option in every neighborhood by providing a public mail service that exists alongside and competes with private options like Federal Express and UPS. Public universities are public options, often providing excellent education at a price far below that of private schools. But families can choose the route that suits them. Public options are everywhere, and they are some of the most celebrated, beloved, important, and effective parts of our society. Public libraries and national parks are obvious treasures, but the list goes on and on. Public swimming pools, public golf courses, public housing, public broadcasting like NPR, public defenders in the courts, public highways and transit systems, public museums like the Smithsonian. Not to mention the humble neighborhood playground. You can take your child to play on the swing set at the public park down the street. Or, if you prefer, you can choose to buy your own and put it in your private backyard. The two of us were talking about how pervasive these public options are when we had our light bulb moment. Why not try public options in other areas? We wondered. Our thoughts turned first to retirement. Both of us had been federal employees early in our careers, and so we knew firsthand that the government has an excellent retirement plan for its workers, providing safe investment options with low fees. Some policy wonks have proposed extending this program to all Americans, and we realized that this would amount to a public option for retirement funding. The possibilities mushroomed as we brainstormed and began our research. Postal banking, that is, a basic bank account offered via the Postal Service, exists in many countries and actually existed in the United States for a big chunk of the 20th century. Such a service could help address the precarious financial position of many low and moderate income families who are not well served by private banks. And on we went. We knew we'd have to think hard and put the ideas through its paces, but it seemed incredibly promising then, and it seems even more so now that we have worked out our ideas in more detail. But we also noticed a puzzle. The public option is thoroughly familiar, and yet it hasn't, outside the specialized arena of healthcare, formed part of the national conversation about the challenges facing the United States in the 21st century. The reason, we have come to believe, is that many Americans have lost faith both in government and in private markets. The anti-government script is part and parcel of American politics these days, and we all know it by heart. Government is bloated, government is wasteful, government is run by bureaucrats who are lazy and incompetent. Markets, in contrast, are said to be efficient and effective. They discipline any bad actors on their own, and they save money while providing excellent services. On this view, it follows that the best, and only, course is to privatize government functions and starve the government leviathan. This romance with the private marketplace took a big hit during the global financial crisis of 2008, when financial markets imploded, largely as a result of speculation, fraud, and illegal behavior. The Great Recession threw millions of Americans out of work, and they learned, or relearned, the lesson that private firms and markets, too, can be bloated, wasteful, and incompetent. In the years since, company after company has been in the news for getting hacked, Equifax, engaged in widespread fraud, Wells Fargo, or scooping up data without our full consent, Facebook. The experience of the Great Recession and the scandals of the years since could leave us mired in cynicism. We could conclude that nothing works, that government and private firms are equally corrupt and incompetent. But the two of us reject this cynical view. We don't think that government or markets are perfect, but neither do we see them as hopelessly incompetent. we think it's not only possible but critical to take a pragmatic look at what government can do well. All around us are public options, schools, universities, parks, social security, that function really well. We should sit up and take notice of the big role that public options already play in everyday life, and we should ask what more they might do. The United States has navigated disruptive social and economic change over and over throughout its history. Now, as then, we can join together to ensure that every American, young, middle-aged, or old, has access to the social infrastructure necessary for a flourishing life. It turns out that public options can help reconstruct that foundation. They could improve access to affordable education, affordable childcare, and secure retirement, just to name a few possibilities, and thus expand freedom, increase opportunity, and promote equality all at the same time. In the last 50 years, one of the most popular public policy solutions to virtually any problem was the market subsidy. A market subsidy drops government money into the marketplace, usually by means of tax subsidies or vouchers. The idea is that the invisible hand of competition will operate to allocate goods like healthcare, college education, and retirement savings in the most beneficial way. But market subsidies have failed, often spectacularly. Prices for healthcare, college, and childcare are higher than ever, and increasingly out of reach for ordinary families. Rather than lowering costs to consumers, subsidies have too often ended up in the pockets of insurance companies and business managers. Public options, by contrast, use direct government provision to ensure universal access. At the same time, they make markets work better. Instead of tossing government dollars into the marketplace, public options provide citizens with services at a guaranteed price and quality. And when they operate alongside private options, they can actually make markets work better simultaneously. We understand the virtue of markets in promoting consumer choice and allocating resources, and we believe that private markets should be allowed to do their work, when they can do it well. What public options do is to provide a reliable starting point for consumers and an anchor for market competition. To understand the potential of public options, however, we must also confront their limitations. Public education is a prime example. Free public education is an important foundation for college and life success, and it has served generations of Americans well. But public schools in poor districts face an array of challenges. Public housing, to take another example, has provided safe and affordable shelter for generations of working-class families. But some housing developments have been badly run or have become havens for crime. Our optimism is not naive. We realize that public options cannot magically solve the economic, social, and political problems of poverty or structural racism. While we mean to restore your faith in such programs, we do not intend to do so by asking you to take anything on faith alone. In Part 1, we make a general case for public options. We explain why and how they can help shore up the social infrastructure of America, ensuring that every citizen has the opportunity to enjoy a productive and healthy life. Chapter 1 tours the dominant approaches to public policy from the end of World War II to the present, the era that saw the expansion of employer-based benefits, followed by deregulation and tax cuts imposed by neoliberals. In Chapter 2, we provide a basic definition of public options and make the case for how they expand freedom and opportunity, improve market competition, are good for businesses, and strengthen our democracy. We then dig deeper in Chapter 3, where we explore how public options relate to alternative market and regulatory approaches to addressing public policy problems. Chapter 4 tackles some counterarguments and discusses the limits of public options. In Part 2, we explain how public options have worked across a variety of sectors. Chapter 5 looks at some prominent successes, ranging from the post office, public libraries, and public swimming pools to Social Security. In Chapter 6, we discuss some of the areas where public options have had serious challenges, including public education and public housing. We investigate what went wrong and why subsidies are not the answer. In Part 3, we consider how a public option could help address critically important sectors of our social infrastructure. Chapters 7 through 12 look in detail at five of these sectors: retirement, higher education, banking, childcare, and healthcare, and suggest some additional areas from broadband internet to credit reporting. Americans have long understood the power of collective action to promote the essential values of freedom and equality. Public options are evidence of our common civic faith. Restoring our confidence in them and expanding their reach will ensure that the 21st century is a time of security and prosperity for all. Part 1. Understanding the public option. 1. The limits of private action. Since the end of World War II, two big ideas have animated American public policy. Employer-sponsored social benefits dominated from the late 1940s through the 1970s. Neoliberalism, prominent from the 1980s through the 2000s, turned to markets and private actors to achieve social goods. Both of these models have now failed, albeit for different reasons. Sea changes in work and family life mean that virtually no one anymore has a lifetime job with union protections and secure benefits. And the financial turmoil of the early 2000s, culminating in the Great Recession, taught us hard lessons about the dangers of relying on unregulated markets. The financial crash triggered mass unemployment and mass foreclosures that ruined lives and still echo today, a decade later. No longer can anyone suppose that the unregulated market will provide a secure platform on which ordinary people can build their lives. Knowing something about the intentions behind both efforts and how and why they came undone is essential before we turn to the promise of public options. The end of the Treaty of Detroit. In the spring of 1950, Walter Reuther, the head of the United Auto Workers, and Charlie Wilson, the head of General Motors, GM, came to an historic agreement. GM would give its workers a monthly $125 pension, cover half the cost of health care, and increase pay in step with increases in the cost of living and rising productivity. Businessweek called it a moment of industrial statesmanship. Fortune dubbed the agreement the Treaty of Detroit. The Treaty of Detroit established the paradigm for American social policy in the post-World War II era. Many people incorrectly think that the mid-20th century was defined by big government liberalism, a system in which the federal government provides a robust welfare state to the American people. But this was not the model for public policy in mid-20th century in America. In fact, American public policy rarely took on the mantle of government-provided social goods. There were a few big government programs, most notably Social Security and Medicare, but these were exceptions, not the rule. As proof, just compare our efforts to those of European countries. European governments provided socialized health care, free college education, and robust social welfare benefits to their citizens regardless of their wealth. The American government did none of those things. Under the Treaty of Detroit, it was General Motors, not Uncle Sam, that provided workers with a pension and health care. In the decades after 1950, this model spread, and it became the norm for much of the industrialized and corporate sectors, whether or not they were unionized. We want to be clear that the employer-based approach was a model, a framework. Not everyone was included in it, and it didn't fully succeed, even on its own terms. But it served as a powerful vision for how social policy was supposed to work. the employer benefits approach was based on a number of assumptions. The first was that people would have the same employer for their entire working life, starting at age 18 or 22 and continuing until retirement at age 65. Employees were expected to be hardworking and responsible. In return for their loyalty, employers paid them a decent wage and their jobs were secure. Retirement meant a big party with friends and family and a gold watch for the employer as a token of appreciation. The second assumption was that employers would provide workers with critical social benefits. Employees would get health care and pensions, and eventually even educational, child care, housing, transportation, and other benefits from their employers, not from the government. Employer-based benefits have been around since the late 19th century, but they took off during the 1940s. Between 1940 and 1945, health insurance coverage expanded from 1.3 million American workers to 32 million workers. After the war, the country continued along the employer-based benefits path instead of creating national programs, as many European countries did. In America, government programs existed largely as a safety net for those who fell through the cracks of the employer-based system. The extremely poor received health care through Medicaid. The elderly and retirees got their health care through Medicare and a minimal pension through Social Security's old age provisions. The disabled, orphans, and widows received a basic income through Social Security. But these were the exceptions. As a general approach to public policy, ordinary Americans would not get their benefits from the government. The third assumption underlying the Treaty of Detroit was that employers would provide a family wage. Families were thought of as a male breadwinner, a stay-at-home wife, and children. When Rutha and Wilson negotiated the Treaty of Detroit, the idea of wages rising with the cost of living and with productivity improvements was partly a function of the need for workers to provide for their families. Indeed, between 1948 and 1978, the median man's income kept pace pretty well with productivity. Productivity rose 108% during this period. Hourly compensation increased 96%. Starting in the 1970s, however, companies increasingly began withdrawing from the Treaty of Detroit. Oil shocks, stagflation, increasing competition from abroad, and an ideological shift that emphasized shareholder profits instead of stakeholder well-being all contributed to corporations shedding the view that they were in it together with their workers. Employers instead increasingly shifted risk onto their workers. One of the best examples of what Jacob Hacker calls the Great Risk Shift was the move from providing defined benefit pension plans to offering defined contribution pension plans. Defined benefit plans give retirees a fixed amount in their yearly pension, which means the risk of market fluctuations is borne by the employer sponsoring the pension. Defined contribution plans, in contrast, involve employees putting money into pension funds and investing that money. The retiree, not the company, bears the risks of market fluctuations. In 1980, there were 30 million defined benefit plan participants, compared to only 19 million defined contribution participants. By 2006, there were only 20 million defined benefit participants, compared to 66 million defined contribution participants. Today's companies rarely, if ever, offer new defined benefit pension plans to their employees. Workers bear the risks of the market. The trouble with the Treaty of Detroit model is that the assumptions undergirding the system of employer-based benefits are no longer reasonable, if they ever were. Americans don't stay in the same job or career for decades. According to a 2016 Gallup study, 21% of millennials reported changing jobs within the past year. This isn't unique to millennials. Even past generations of workers went through multiple job transitions throughout their lifetimes. When people do work for companies, they increasingly are not actual employees of the company. The most prominent example is Uber, and the gig economy. Uber claims that drivers are just using their mobile platform, and they are therefore not employees of the tech company. On this understanding of the gig economy, because workers are not employees, the company doesn't have to provide benefits, no retirement package, no health insurance, no unemployment insurance. The gig economy might get the most attention, but technology companies aren't the only or even the most common cases of this phenomenon. Consider a housekeeper working at the San Francisco Marriott. Even though its name is prominently displayed outside, Marriott doesn't own the property. A company called Host Hotels and Resorts does. Nor does Marriott employ the housekeeper or manage her hours or payroll. That's the job of Crestline Hotels and Resorts, a hotel management company. Marriott does establish guidelines for how the housekeeping staff is supposed to maintain the hotel rooms, but this is a far cry from the old days, in which Marriott would have owned the property, managed the hotel, and employed the people working there. This example, taken from David Weil's The Fissured Workplace, shows just how far the employer-employee relationship has changed in the last generation. Today, Weil argues, workplaces across a variety of sectors have been fractured, leading to complex employment relationships. Employees are now often working for contractors or subcontractors. Sometimes they are independent contractors who have no direct relationship with the company at all. Whether you call it the gig economy, the 1099 economy, or the patchwork economy, the common theme is that workers are increasingly cobbling together different forms of employment, part-time, gig, independent contracting, and self-employment. They aren't working for a single employer. The decline of the lifetime employer idea and the fissuring of American workplaces strike at the very core of the Treaty of Detroit's employer-based benefits model. It makes little sense for employers to pay expensive pensions to a worker whose tenure is only a few years. And for workers who switch jobs frequently, it is a hassle to change retirement plans and health care providers every time they move to a new company. When companies use independent contractors or gig workers, the situation is even more problematic. These individuals don't get any benefits. The legacy of the Treaty of Detroit leaves them out in the cold. The basic idea behind the family wage hasn't fared well either. Almost every assumption behind the imagined ideal of a 1950s-style family, where dad comes home from work to a stay-at-home mom and a couple of kids, is out of date. While wages and productivity grew together in the Treaty of Detroit era, the ordinary male worker's wages have been stagnant since the 1970s. True household incomes continued to rise through the 1970s and 1980s until about 2000. But this was partly because women entered the workforce in increasing numbers. In May 1950, when the Treaty of Detroit was signed, 33% of women were in the workforce. 50 years later, in May 2000, that number was 60%. Women's income buoyed households that were already struggling under the model of breadwinner liberalism. Whether or not the Treaty of Detroit paradigm suited the age of managerial corporations, it is certainly out of sync with employment and families today. Adhering to the approach of employer-based benefits makes little sense given contemporary conditions. While some people might be nostalgic for the America of the 1950s, nostalgia is rarely a good guide to public policy. The perils of neoliberalism. As companies withdrew from the Treaty of Detroit, a second paradigm for public policy took hold. Neoliberalism was defined by its desire to use markets as the means to achieve social goals, and by its view that markets were an end in themselves. Ideologically, neoliberalism grew out of a conservative intellectual movement that was powered by anti-government Austrian economic theorists who fled Europe in the mid-20th century, and it was buoyed by the Cold War and the fear of communism. It gained political dominance with the elections of Ronald Reagan in the United States and Margaret Thatcher in the United Kingdom, and became virtually universal when liberals turned to neoliberal policies in the 1990s and 2000s. When it came to public policy, neoliberals thought that markets, rooted in strong private property and contract rights, were the best way to achieve the well-being of society and to preserve and advance freedom for all. On their theory, government would do little more than enforce contract and property rights. If government was going to act to advance broader social goals, like health or education, it would do so through private markets. Privatization involved outsourcing government functions to profit-seeking companies. Deregulation became central to neoliberalism because it freed markets to act without constraints. Vouchers, state-provided coupons to purchase private services, became the dominant approach for how government could advance social goals by market means. When we look back from beyond the 2008 crash, neoliberalism seems woefully naive. But Reagan-era policymakers were facing their own age of anxiety and were searching for an alternative to old institutions that no longer seemed viable. The economic chaos of the late 1970s, with high inflation and economic stagnation, called for desperate measures. The old Treaty of Detroit model was already moribund. Modern economics had resurrected Adam Smith and the promise that an unregulated, laissez-faire market could do a better job than any command and control government intervention. And we cannot forget the role of the Cold War. Neoliberalism equated markets with freedom and big government with Soviet-style planned economies. Unfettered capitalism, the Reaganites believed, could pull the United States out of the economic doldrums of the late 1970s and provide the fuel needed to win a decisive economic, political, and ideological victory against the Soviets. But in retrospect, we know that neoliberalism had a number of failings, including an almost religious faith in markets, even in the face of empirical evidence of their failings and flaws. Unquestioning acceptance of market efficiency often led proponents to ignore fundamental problems with the neoliberal approach. That profit-seeking actors would try to use fraud, force, and deception to cheat people for their own gain. That markets can lead to the concentration of economic power and, as a result, undermine the very functioning of competitive markets. And that profit-seeking actors would seek to use government to benefit themselves, at the expense of taxpayers, consumers, and a competitive market. All of these neoliberal problems came home to roost at one time or another, and sometimes all at the same time. Consider the neoliberal turn in higher education, for-profit colleges. Instead of the government funding public universities and community colleges directly, and allowing people to attend private, non-profit colleges if they desire, the neoliberal approach urged two things. First, private profit-seeking actors should run institutions of higher education. Second, the government should give students a voucher to go to whatever school they wanted. The vouchers in this case are Pell Grants, federal grants given to students directly for use at any college or university, and federal student loans, some of which the government subsidizes by not requiring students to pay interest while in school. On the neoliberal model, students can use Pell Grants and federal student loans at any school in the market, public, nonprofit, or for-profit. The hope was the market would create new and better options for students. So how did the experiment turn out? The neoliberal higher education model turned into a way for shareholders and CEOs to make boatloads of money off taxpayers by deceiving prospective students, saddling them with unconscionable levels of debt, and leaving them without a decent education or any reasonable job prospects. According to a report from the U.S. Senate Committee on Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions in 2009, 86% of the revenues for the 15 publicly traded for-profit colleges came from taxpayer dollars. Think about what that means. For every $100 of revenue that for-profits earned, $86 came from taxpayers, and only $14 came from other sources. And the absolute dollars at stake are large. In the 2009 to 2010 school year alone, the U.S. government invested $32 billion in for-profits, or a whopping 25% of the Department of Education's budget for student aid programs. Pell Grants alone amounted to $7.5 billion, up from only $1.1 billion in 2000 to 2001. Neoliberalism's faults are somewhat more subtle. One example is basic banking services. Most of the time, we don't notice that dollar bills say on them, legal tender. What that means is that the government has mandated that bills can be used to pay for goods and services. For a variety of reasons, including security and technology, most employers don't pay their employees in legal tender, in cash. Instead, they pay either with a check or with direct deposit. For many people, that isn't a big deal. It's convenient. You just go to the bank and deposit the check, or if you have direct deposit, the money automatically appears in your account. But 7% of American households, 15.6 million adults and 7.6 million children, don't have a bank account. As a result, just to get access to the money that they are owed for their work, they have to use check cashing establishments that charge exorbitant fees. Neoliberalism's faith in markets also too often ignores the consequences of concentrated economic power. In this case, a lesson from history went ignored. In the late 19th and early 20th centuries, industrialization led to massive consolidation of industry. During the great merger movement of 1895 to 1904, more than 1,800 firms disappeared. By 1904, 40% of American industry was under the control of only 300 corporations. Concentrated economic power had a variety of detrimental consequences. It meant that employers had more power over their workers. It meant that monopolies could raise prices on customers. And it meant that corporations and their wealthy leadership had more resources to influence public policy. In response, progressive era reformers passed antitrust laws and public utilities regulations in order to break up or regulate concentrated economic power. They did so not just for economic reasons of efficiency, but also for constitutional reasons. They understood that America could not remain a republic, it could not have political freedom, if power was concentrated in a small number of corporations that were trying to rig the political system to serve their interests. Three generations later, during the ascendancy of neoliberalism, Robert Bork, then a professor and later a judge, penned a famous tract, The Antitrust Paradox, arguing that antitrust policy should not take into account political factors, the market ecosystem, or anything except economic efficiency. As Bork's ideas took hold, antitrust prosecutions languished. Today, we are in the midst of what The Economist calls the Great Merger Wave. Looking at 900 sectors of the economy, the magazine found that two-thirds had become more concentrated between 1997 and 2012. Concentrated power, once again, means less competition, higher prices, and the increasing political power of big monopolies that control virtually every aspect of American lives. Of course, the 2008 economic crash was one of the consequences of the long neoliberal moment. Deregulation meant deceptive and fraudulent practices in a variety of sectors, including the housing and financial markets. The neoliberal preference to facilitate social goals through government-supported vouchers, subsidies, and incentives only deepened this pathology. Federally supported housing finance allowed financial institutions to capture the benefits of their bets without bearing the risks when those bets went bad. And consolidation and concentration in the financial sector produced Wall Street banks that were too big to fail, leading to government bailouts. Despite its many problems, fondness for, if not necessarily robust faith in, neoliberalism remained strong. Many people remain nostalgic for this easy-to-understand approach to public policy. But the financial debacle of 2008 to 2009 and its continuing aftershocks should leave Americans in no doubt. Nostalgia for neoliberalism is perilous. We need better options. Beyond privatization, the possibilities of public options. The public option challenges the privatization agenda by turning it on its head. Privatizers begin with the assumptions, often undefended, that government programs are always and everywhere ineffective and corrupt, and that private markets work perfectly. It's no surprise, then, that they propose to turn over public functions, ranging from prisons to roads to welfare programs, to private firms that are motivated by profits. The case for public options, by contrast, doesn't rest on black and white assumptions about either government or the private sector. We don't assume that government always works well, or that government should muscle out private provision. Instead, we think that public options can add social value when the power of the government is needed to guarantee universal access to the basics of modern life. So public options aren't socialist-style big government. They don't aim to replace markets. Instead, public options exist alongside market options. Citizens can rely on the public option, but also can turn to the marketplace for additional choices, combining public and private options in ways that work best for them. 2. Why public options? The social contract evolves as society changes. In its time, the Treaty of Detroit supported an idea of the social contract that had wide appeal. A lifetime job at a wage that enabled workers to support their families by buying necessities and having the middle class dream of a house, a car, an annual vacation, and a secure retirement. So the values behind the social contract in that era was something like, if you are willing to work hard, you can have a good life. In that era, with or without a high school diploma, let alone a college degree, Americans could expect to participate in the good life as long as they were willing to work or to marry a worker, in the case of many women. The Treaty of Detroit was a market system, since workers paid for all of this out of their wages. But it wasn't laissez-faire by any stretch of the imagination. Government rules supported labor unions and subsidized employer-provided benefits. This system, as Chapter 1 described, fell apart as economic and social conditions changed. Without economic growth and a robust demand for unskilled labor, the treaty could no longer guarantee profits to firms along with plentiful jobs for workers of all backgrounds. The neoliberal market subsidies that gained prominence between the 1980s and the early 2000s, by contrast, expressed a very different social contract. Its values were something like, everyone has to look out for themselves in the marketplace, but the government will provide a few extra dollars to buy important goods for people who have extremely bad luck in the market. That market ideal answered the access and accountability questions in a characteristic way. Citizens should buy whatever education they needed to succeed in the marketplace. As savvy consumers, they should vet providers, like colleges and employers, for themselves. Market subsidies would help poorer students take out loans, but students had to figure out for themselves what jobs would pay the most and how much student debt was too much. so those who picked the wrong majors or were bilked by for-profit schools, well, they had only themselves to blame. The logic of neoliberalism spread well beyond college and employment, of course. Retirees were told to save for their own retirement with, or often without, government subsidies. Workers were left to choose their own investments and their own advisors. And savers who lost money in the stock market crash or who paid outrageous fees to unscrupulous banks, well, they should have made better choices. The Great Recession dampened Washington's enthusiasm for the neoliberal social contract. After the crash of 2008, it became much harder to ignore the failures of the marketplace. Big banks' predatory and risky practices came to light, as did profiteering in the student loan market by financial institutions and for-profit colleges. No longer was it tenable to suppose that market subsidies alone would give everyone a fair shake. But policymakers and citizens alike are struggling to find a new mode of policymaking that expresses an appealing social contract for our time. This is where public options can contribute to a national conversation about what we owe each other, as well as to a wonkier discussion about policy tools. Public options express a collective commitment to freedom, to opportunity, and to markets that distribute resources fairly amid the realities of globalization, the gig economy, and modern family life. What is a public option? Many people may have encountered the public option during debates over healthcare. In that context, a public option is a government-provided health insurance policy, think Medicare, that is universally available to every American. But it is also an option. If you don't want to use Medicare for your health insurance, you don't have to. You can buy private health insurance instead. The key is that under a public option, the provision of health care doesn't depend on an employer, as in the Treaty of Detroit model, or on profit-seeking corporations, as under the neoliberal model. Of course, while the public option was discussed in health policy circles in the 1990s and 2000s, it was never enacted. We can now begin to specify what distinguishes the public option from other policy approaches.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.